to one of our favorites, Jon Stewart, was also on another one of our favorites, Joe Rogan's podcast. It came out over the weekend. It was a really incredible conversation. We can't play all of it for you, but one of the areas where Jon, because he was only doing media criticism largely, and he was constrained by Comedy Central and all that, couldn't talk about some of the more deeper issues. He had this fantastic observation from 2008, where he was actually talking to the Treasury Secretary at the time, probably Geithner or Hank Paulson, I can't remember. Whichever one, either Hank Paulson under Bush or Geithner under Obama, probably under Obama because we're talking Geithner, about mortgages. Yeah. And what he was saying was, he asked Geithner, he said, what if you just made people's mortgages whole so that all of the bets placed on them just turned out to be okay, instead of buying the trillions of dollars of debt? And Geithner, or whoever it was he was talking to at the time, said, yeah, but that would be a moral hazard. And Jon is like, well, so you're saying there's a moral hazard in teaching people that you can make them whole on their mortgage, but there's not a moral hazard whenever you give money to the banks, which bet hundreds of billions of dollars of bets on people's mortgages. And the Treasury Secretary was like, it's just different. You know, it's just different. The whole too big to fail thing. It's just kind of amazing because I think it exactly exemplifies what's happening now, which is that people are like, how are we going to bail out the stock market? How are we going to bail out, this business or that business? The easiest way to do it is to downstream give people money. Our economy runs, 70% of our economy is consumer spending. If you give consumers money to spend, all the other chinks in the chain, they'll be taken care of. But they can't do that, Ryan, because of moral hazard. But it's not a moral hazard in order to take care of, like, the cruise line industry, which isn't even flagged here in the United States, flagged in Bahamas explicitly to avoid taxes. Right. And now they're supposed to get our money while our citizens, you know, don't have anything. I just think it's ridiculous. I thought Jon just put it perfectly in calling out the ludicrousness of that argument.
Yeah, and it comes down to a fundamental question of who needs to be disciplined by the market and by the government. And so the neoliberal strain of economics, which then has its own strains that run before it, has always said you need to discipline the people. If you don't check them with routine bouts of misery, unemployment, and poverty, then who knows what they're going to demand from their betters. Versus the others who say, no, that actually the people that control the economy or have the power to control the economy are the financial sector. Mm-hmm. And so those are the folks that you actually need to discipline, because what they need to be is a utility that provides ways to get investment capital out into productive areas of the country. That's it. They don't need to do anything more than that. And the second that they start doing a whole lot more than that, you're going to start seeing investments distorted. You're going to see money siphoned off the top.
Right.
Now, if you think about it, if a water utility executive had 8 swimming pools and nobody else could even fill up a bathtub before it got cold, the public would be like, wait a minute, you're running a water utility. You're not supposed to have all the water. You're just supposed to distribute it to everybody else. And that's what we have with Wall Street now, which is it's what ought to be a utility. What was described as a utility early in capitalism has developed into everybody that they just are keeping these massive pools of this capital. And what they learned from 2008 is if they take these reckless risks and they go belly up, then they will be taken care of. And that is the precise definition of a moral hazard.
That is literally a moral hazard. And one of the things that Jon also says, he talks about how the investor class has gotten a break, how we've overvalued investment and devalued work. And he has, and this is a very common theme here, which is that when everything fell apart, right, in March, right, and it really just seemed like it was going to be a complete disaster. What happened? Well, we found out who was essential, and it turned out to be people, construction workers, grocery store workers, and others. But what did we also learn about them? They are the most economically precarious in America. They're living paycheck to paycheck. They're a blown tire away from bankruptcy, many of them. And whenever it came time to raise their wages, nobody in this town stepped up. I mean, people talked to big game Democrats, some Democrats, not even all of them, were like, yeah, let's raise the minimum wage, or let's have an essential workers. Mitt Romney, I want to give him huge credit, has talked about a $12 per hour raise for essential workers. None of it has come to materialize. Not one. Many of them have even lost the temporary benefits that they had. So what has come their way? Nothing. And yet, you know, stocks, the Federal Reserve is going, you know, over time, you know, pumping cheap credit and liquidity and all of that into the system. And look, stocks are connected to the real economy in some form. And largely, I think stock prices as well as consumer prices are only because people have that expanded unemployment insurance right now. But if that does not get made up in some way, and I accept even the argument that that could might, you know, screw with wages and getting people back to work and all that, but it needs to be made up more on the business side and on making sure we bolster consumer demand. They don't want to do any of that. And I just think, once again, we're going to have a whole house of cards collapse, and we're just going to take care of everybody out here on the front end. And the back end people, this time, they didn't even take out risky mortgages. Again, I don't even blame them for that, because many of them were deceptively, you know, they were deceptively pushing to taking out these mortgages. This time, they had to stay home to be safe. That was it, right? And they didn't do anything wrong, and they're not getting taken care of. So I just think it's a perfect, you know, kind of a perfect comparison to what's happening right now in our system.
Right, and there was a brief moment where essential workers were being celebrated, but right. They were often just being celebrated by kind of videos that the good companies would
by PMC
would put out.
Liberals with signs in there. I see it all over my neighborhood. Thank you, essential workers. I'm like, all right,
right.
Fine.
And we'll see how much they care about these workers when you know the current rounds of stimulus wind up, mm-hmm. and whether or not they come back and take care of people again who are just putting their lives at risk to do the work to keep people alive and to keep the economy going.
Yeah, I just don't see it happening. But, you know, from wise words from Jon Stewart, I encourage everybody to go listen to the entire episode. Jon is just one of the, you know, most brilliant people around. All right, tomorrow on Rising, we have Fox News political reporter Paul Steinhauser. He's going to tell us what's happening out there on the virtual campaign trail.
And we'll dive into the economics of protests versus riots with Matt Stoller.
That's always fun. Stoller's a fun one. All right, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to always see our videos. We'll see you guys tomorrow.